रहे हो?
No, I'll be starting sharp at 4:30, because if some people come sharp at 4:30, they should not feel that they have missed anything. Jai Baba.
Jai Baba.
God alone is real, and as we are permanently lodged in the divine beloved, we are all one. Meher Baba. Avatar Meher Baba ki jai. Thank you, beloved Baba, and Jai Baba to all of you. We are meeting once again in beloved Baba's remembrance, in his name, just to please him. We are reading page number 81 of God Speaks. Part 8 is page number is 81, paragraph number 3. Go ahead.
You take the question?
No. आपका प्रश्न अभी हो गया है ना? Almost, बस he understood. Yeah. Oh, go ahead. God.
God, in his original state of infinitude, is eternally infinite through his infinite, unbounded, and unlimited triune nature of infinite power, infinite knowledge, and infinite bliss. As God eternally is, the only virtual difference between the original state of God and the new states of God that he acquires is that of the consciousness gained progressively through the impressions of the projected nothingness.
In the earlier chapters we had done that the only reality is God. All souls are one. The only difference between the apparent souls is the difference in consciousness. God has always been there. God is now, and God will forever and ever remain. What is the difference between an ant, a sparrow, a donkey, and a human being? That everything is God playing the role of ant and a sparrow and a donkey and a human being. The difference is in the consciousness. And where does this difference in consciousness come from? From the accumulation and the experiencing of samskaras. So that is all that makes the difference. Here Baba says, God in his original state of infinitude is eternally infinite through his infinite, unbounded, and unlimited triune nature of infinite power, infinite knowledge, and infinite bliss. Even at this point in time, all of us has got infinite power, infinite knowledge, and infinite bliss. But that is all covered, enveloped, shrouded by consciousness, by the samskaras, as a result of which we are not able to experience the infinite power, the infinite knowledge. We have got knowledge, but not the infinite knowledge. We have got bliss. We experience through our body happiness and suffering, but not infinite bliss. So here Baba says that this, because of the triune nature, as God eternally is, eternity concerns the time. In eternity, there is no time. Time came into being. Time is a construct of the mind. Mind came into being because of the impressions or sanskaras. Because of the mind, we are dividing time into past, present, and future. In eternity, Baba says, there is no time. There is only one eternal now, which is inclusive of all the so-called apparent past and all the future. It encompasses everything. There is only one moment, and that is now. Very difficult for to understand. Why? Because we are trying to understand through the mind. And mind has been trained to think in terms of lateral, past, present, future. yesterday, today, tomorrow. And therefore, it's very difficult for us to understand that there is no time. So Baba says, as God eternally is, the only virtual difference between the original state of God and the new states of God. All these are new states of God. Fish, bird, animal, human beings are new states of God. The only difference between the original state of God and the new states of God that he acquires is that the consciousness gained is the consciousness gained progressively through the impressions of the projected nothingness. So the only difference that, if at all you call it a difference, is because of the impressions which we have gained through, Baba says, the impressions of the projected nothingness. A fish is experiencing something. Why? Because of the projected nothingness. A human being, again, experiencing something because of the projected impressions. So as long as the impressions are there, as long as the samskars are there, the consciousness is bound to see only the form, only the periphery level of. Once all the consciousness are dissolved, totally dissolved, then the soul will see the self, or it will see itself as I am God. Go ahead.
God, in his original state of God is not conscious of his infinite eternal existence, nor of his own infinite nature, though he exists infinitely and eternally. Due to his own infinite whim, God acquires the consciousness of his reality and realizes his infinite, eternal, unlimited self to experience his unbounded, unlimited, and infinite triune nature.
We had seen it earlier that God in the God is state, isness. That is the real state, as Baba talks in 10 states of God, state 1, where God is, but consciousness is not. Everything that is in that God is state, but there is no consciousness. And that state, Baba says, is equivalent to exactly the same state we all go in when we go in the sound sleep state. When we are in sound sleep state, that means not this state which is called the false awake state, not the dream state where we use our subtle senses in order to see the dreams connected with gross things and gross people and all that, not that state. A state where I am, but the consciousness that I am is not there. That is the sound sleep or deep sleep state. That is the exact state of God is state in the Paratpar Parbrahma state. So in all this, what do we get to know? We get to know one thing, that every single moment of time, we are all in God. We can never ever be separated from God. And every night or even day, when we go into sound sleep state, we are one with Paratpar Parbrahma. And that is why when we wake up in the morning, sometimes we feel very invigorated, very fresh. Some problems are there, we sleep with the problem, but when we wake up, we get the solution because we have gone into the God is state and have come back from that state. So sorry, did I read this? No. Oh. God in his original state of God is not conscious of his infinite eternal existence. He's not conscious of anything. That is why that hooky, I want to know who am I, that way. Is not conscious of the infinite eternal existence, nor of his own infinite nature, though he exists infinitely and eternally. Due to his own infinite whim, God acquires the consciousness of his reality and realizes his infinite, eternal, unlimited self to experience his unbounded, unlimited, an infinite trio nature. That means it is the whim, the primal cause, the original cause, the who am I, the hooky, whatever name we want to call it, you know, the urge to know, you know, that is what created all this hulchal. And after eons, you can say, if you measure in time, God came to know that He is God and that He is having this trio nature of infinite knowledge, power and bliss, and He experiences that.
Thus, God, now with His newly acquired state of eternal consciousness, is consciously and eternally aware of His original beyond the beyond state of God is, which is forever and ever unconscious of the infinitude of His own God is state.
Thus God, now God has completed the entire journey. Thus God, now with His newly acquired state of eternal consciousness, is consciously and eternally aware of His original beyond the beyond state of God is. So you start from absolute unconsciousness to the bestirring of that very, very minuscule, as Baba says, most finite consciousness, starting from the gaseous state, and then you go back to that state. The world of difference is that it started from a point of absolutely most finite consciousness, and it ended in the consciousness of what we call as the full eternal infinite consciousness. In other words, very important to understand, God never goes back to the beyond state. Try to understand. It's everything started from the beyond state and it ends with the beyond state. In other words, now God, who is totally conscious, in other words, in the beyond state, which is called state 2B, when we come to the charts, God is conscious of His unconsciousness. He consciously experiences the beyond state of God. Now here there's a dichotomy. How can you be awake in sound sleep state? Sound sleep state is totally different. So being awake in the sound sleep, now we go into sound sleep state, what happens? We know we are going to sleep slowly, and one moment we go into the dream state, because that's the pathway. You can't go into the sound sleep just like that. Your pathway is the dream state. You go into the dream state and then you lose your consciousness and go into the sound sleep state. The moment we go into the sound sleep state, we are in a sense lost to myself. I'm lost to myself. I don't know. I'm existing. I'm breathing. But I don't know that I'm existing. So if I can be conscious in my sound sleep state, then that is equivalent to God realization. So God, after finishing the entire journey, the travail, goes back to the beyond state. He starts from state 2A and goes through state 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, which is, when we come to it, we'll understand, you know, and then goes back to state 8, which is experiencing one with God, God realization. So what this means is that God is now aware and conscious of His sound sleep state.
Thus, God, therefore, the goal is to realize the eternal and infinite God state consciously.
The goal is to realize that state. It is highlighted, bold, consciously. Because the moment we go there, we become unconscious. So we have to be there and yet remain conscious.
As already described, the original state of God is that state of unbounded absolute vacuum where God is and consciousness is not.
We know that.
This state is the original divine sound sleep state of God beyond the beginning of the beginning of creation.
So this is some place where even the creation has not started, beyond the beginning of the beginning of creation.
The original infinite whim of God as the cause is responsible for breaking the spell of the original divine sound sleep state of God, and the result, which is creation, is called the effect.
So in other words, there is a cause.
Whim.
Sorry? A whim. Urge. Hooky. And there is an effect. What is the effect of that cause? Creation. Right.
In order to grasp clearly the divine sound sleep state and understand more clearly all that follows immediately after the original infinite whim surges in God, bestirring him from the divine sound sleep, let the divine sound sleep state of God be compared with the sound sleep of man.
In order to grasp clearly, now Baba is very, like how we teach small children, gradually he's saying now equivalent, the beyond state of God is equivalent to a normal man in his sound sleep state. The word bestirring would mean that it to make active. Now God is sleeping. The cause has now, in a sense, awoken God.
This sound sleep state of man is literally the same original divine sound sleep state of God.
Stop here. Huh? Very important. Again, I've been emphasizing, but we are repeating Baba's words, you know. This sound sleep state of man, and when Baba says man, it includes woman also. That means the woman also go to the beyond state of God. This sound sleep state of man is literally the same original divine sound sleep state of God. Literally, not something like as if almost equivalent to, no, literally the same state. Yes. The question is whether the man God also experiences this sound sleep state consciously. Yes. Anybody who has experienced Aham Brahmasmi, I am God state, Anal Hak, Soham, God realization, self realization, whether he is a Mazhub-e Kamil, whether he is a Brahmi Bhut, whether he is a Salik, whether he is a Kutub, everybody who has experienced God, I am God, oneness with God, will experience this state. That means he is forever and ever awake and conscious of the sound sleep state. Yeah. But they don't go back to that state. They stop the journey at the beyond state of God, not the beyond. Because the whole purpose is to come out of the beyond and end the journey in the beyond. Right?
God in the God is state is eternally in the original divine sound sleep state, whereas God in the human state daily experiences alternately the sound sleep state and the awake state.
So in other words, God in the God is state is eternally, that means forever and ever, in the sound sleep state, whereas the man who goes into the sound sleep state alternates between awake and sound sleep. Awake and
God
sound sleep.
God in the human state.
God in the human state, yeah. Okay.
The infinite, impressionless and formless, eternal God experiences himself as finite, limited, inanimate or animate forms or beings only because of the advent of the first most finite impression of the nothing that manifested as nothingness.
Okay. The infinite, impressionless, there's no impressions, no samskaras, and formless, eternal God experiences himself as finite, limited, inanimate, which means gases, stones, metals, minerals, inanimate, or animate forms with life, having life, or beings only because of the advent of the first most finite impression of the nothing that manifested as nothingness. So in other words, what makes the difference between the God is eternal, infinite, unbounded state, and what we are, and what God is experiencing within us, in us, is because of the impressions. It started with the most finite impression, and that it kept on expanding. Evolution kept on happening. With more and more evolution, more and more samskars were attracted. We gathered so many samskaras, and now there are all very different samskaras. So what to do? I can't utilize those samskaras in this form, so I have to change another form, which is more complex or more developed or higher than the form in which I have accumulated the past samskaras. Very clear? This is how it happened. Yeah, you have a question. 1 minute. I think you take the mic by, because people are online should be able to hear the question.
Is there any method to know how much samskaras are left, or
okay? Somebody had asked, how will I know that my purpose in life is already accomplished or not? How much? Then the answer was, since you are still alive and struggling, in a sense, it shows that they are still there and you have to finish it. How many? There's no quantum. There's no measure as to what are the samskaras. Because samskaras are so subtle that they need to be balanced quantitatively and qualitatively in order to experience mukti, moksha, whatever. Right? And that is beyond our ken, beyond our way of doing it. The only way to get out of this circuitous coming and going is trying to remember Baba when we breathe our last. And Baba says that if you are able to do that, then you will get mukti or moksha. This is my understanding of Baba's, my wish, the last wish, where Baba says that whosoever takes my name at the time of breathing his last comes to me. But there's no measure, the scale, weighing scale, that how many samskaras are there. Maybe in future they may come. So you stand on the weighing scale and just like, how you know what is your weight? They will tell you what are the samskaras remaining. That way. Just joking. Anyway, all right.
At one stage in the evolution of consciousness, the impressions of the nothing imparts to God the experiences of the human state.
At one stage in the evolution of consciousness, which is that stage? The final last stage of evolution of consciousness, where consciousness is whole and complete, where a human being is supposedly made in the likeness and image of God Himself. In one stage in the evolution of consciousness, the impressions of the nothing impart to God. This is important to understand, that everything is happening to God only. I don't exist in reality. You see, God in the vegetable stage, God in the insect or worm stage, God in the fish, bird, animal stage, and now God in the human stage. So it imparts to God the experiences of the human state. Who is experiencing human state? It is God who is experiencing the human state. These impressions
of the nothing are just the procreation of the original, most finite first impression picked up by the most finite first ray of consciousness in God, made manifest simultaneously when the latent original infinite whim surged in God and projected the latent all of the most finite nothing as nothingness.
Imagine how difficult it must have been for Baba to dictate. To dictate on the alphabet board this whole book. It was originally on the alphabet board. And subsequently Baba, later part we understand is Baba, so certain very complex words, because Baba had left the alphabet board on 7th October 1954. And after that, when he said he would make one of the Manli, maybe Bauji, maybe Eraj, to say A, B, C, D, E, F, G, stop. And then that becomes one letter of the word. And then blah, 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 stop. And that is how the words were formed. how difficult, what effort Baba must have taken in order to complete this book. Okay, where is it?
These impressions
of the nothing are just the procreation of the original most finite first impressions picked up by the most finite first ray of consciousness in God, made manifest simultaneously when the latent original infinite whim surged in God and projected the latent all of the most finite nothing as nothingness. So in other words, to understand it simply would mean that these impressions of nothing, they emerged the moment the urge or the who am I came about, and with that emergence the most finite impressions or samskaras got accumulated in the most first, whatever you call it, gases, or the gases were the first form. In other words, what are those impressions? These impressions were nothing but the nothingness of the nothing, which wrapped up the consciousness of the soul, and that is how the whole journey began. I think we keep the mic here only. Yeah, because bolo.
When Baba stopped using alphabet, but then you said that he was A B C D E F G A. Nobody from the Mandali said, Baba, instead of doing all this, why don't you write it down?
We should have said it. But you were not there in the Mandali at that time. No, otherwise you would have. Baba stopped writing from 2nd of January 1927. He never wrote anything except for putting his signatures or initials wherever he deemed necessary, or wherever it was legally necessary. Otherwise he stopped writing. Sir? No, he did keep signing till quite, even these God Speaks were signed and autographed by Baba. I think some 490 odd pages. 398. Okay. So yes, he did sign. Yeah. Sorry? No, there was nothing written. See, it... No. Baba doesn't require anybody's idea or anybody's advice. He knows what he's doing, yeah. But the important thing that we are trying to understand is what an effort Baba has made to dictate this book, and the importance that Baba has given to this book. Although we may not find, it may be the future aspirant people who are perhaps more intelligent than us, they'll be able to really probe into it and try to figure out why Baba wrote the way he has written. You know, it is not a simple book, you know, it's not simple. It is very repetitive in a sense, and he's emphasizing so much in the most finite and most next, and you know, for that kind of thing. So there is some element of the purpose for it. And Baba himself has said that whenever he dictates, or he, you know, either through gestures or through the alphabet board, every syllabus, every word is ingrained or power-packed with a spiritual energy that will help us in some way, whether we understand it or not. This is what we got from Don Stevens. When Don asked that, these are all just, I said, no, it has a lot of importance. So, and Baba himself said that nothing of this kind has ever been written before, and we understand this as the magnum opus of Baba's cosmology. There are people who, even today, science is not able to understand. They could not even define consciousness. In today's date and time, there is no one definition of consciousness. There are various definitions, you know. But in other words, Baba has gone deep into consciousness. Baba has got deep into creation. And most important, the samskars, which takes us from one level to the other level.
Those who have read Gita and all, they must be saying that these things are in Gita also, something like.
No, I don't think Gita has anything about this. There's nothing about Gita in this.
No. My question.
Gita will also have this material. We don't know. She is red.
No,
she
no,
is
no, no. Gita is a totally different thing.
But that was also written by Baba only, ne? When he was in form of Krishna.
Correct.
Yes. There is no repetition of Gita in this God speaks.
No. At certain places, karma, samskar, law of karma is always there, but not in such specific details. According to me, no. No, Gita is just the song which
because
was
Baba
on the battle of Kurukshetra. That's about all, basically.
No,
of course, it has a lot of learning. There's no doubt about it. But Baba at that time thought of giving that. Later on, he thought of giving this.
Because he said this has never been given in the past. So we can conclude such from
detailed,
that one,
minute.
From the one sentence, we can say that this is it. It's not coming.
All right, go ahead.
The original most finite impression multiplied and increased simultaneously and concurrently with the evolution of the most finite original trickle of consciousness.
That means initially there was only a trickle of consciousness, very, very minute consciousness, you know, and then it multiplied, simultaneously multiplying because of what we know, because of accumulation of sanskaras. And the samskaras are impressions, and impressions will never go away unless and until there is an expression of the impression. And when there is an expression of the impression, there is an experience, and this experience again binds you with further impressions. So that's the vicious circle, and it goes on and on and on.
The multifarious and varied impressions so formed were experienced by the greater evolution of consciousness through multifarious and varied media of finite or gross forms, because the impressions formed must necessarily be experienced by the consciousness. But for consciousness to experience the impressions, suitable media were absolutely necessary.
What I said just now, it basically means the same thing, that multifarious would mean diverse impressions. We've all gone through everything that has to be experienced. The multifarious and varied impressions so formed were experienced by the greater evolution of consciousness. I have created impressions. Now, for example, I am creating impressions in this life. The good, the bad, the ugly. If I don't remember Baba, then all these impressions will have to be experienced in my next birth. Correct? And what I am experiencing now, whether I am happy or sad or what is my nature, everything was determined by the impressions that had been gathered in my last advent, in my last incarnation. So this is how it keeps going and going and going.
When will it end?
It will end when it has to end. All films have to end, no? So it will, when you read the end, that means it has ended. All right. So I think so far we are very clear about this. Go ahead.
Thus, the evolution of consciousness goes on evolving further and greater consciousness in conformity with the evolution of gross forms of relatively higher and higher types in order to experience the impressions gathered in conjunction with the preceding relatively lower types of gross media.
So these are both running simultaneously. There is consciousness which is running ahead. And what is consciousness doing? It is accumulating fresh sanskaras and spending some sanskaras, and in the process it requires a more suitable form. Here it is mentioned over here, but for the consciousness to experience the impressions, suitable media were absolutely, media means the form, form means the body, the gross form. So here what Baba is saying, thus the evolution of consciousness goes on evolving further and greater consciousness in conformity with the evolution of gross forms of relatively higher and higher types in order to experience the impressions gathered in conjunction with they are all jointly going together, what? Consciousness and form, in conjunction with the preceding relatively lower types of gross media. So every media is going higher and higher and higher type. It is never retrogressive. Just as consciousness is not retrogressive or going behind or going backwards. In the same way, the forms are also going higher and higher and higher.
In short, the most finite first impression of the original infinite vim surging in God gave to the unconscious infinite God the most finite consciousness. Gradually, varied impressions multiplied and increased and gained greater finite consciousness for God until eventually the evolution of consciousness was complete when the impressions of full consciousness gained identified God with human form.
So in the human form, first human form, consciousness is whole and complete. Simultaneously with the development of the gross form or the gross body, the subtle body and the mental body was also unconsciously and gradually developing in the pre-human stages, like animals, birds, fishes. It was gradually gaining. And in the human form, the first human form, simultaneously with the consciousness being full and final, it also has fully developed subtle body and mental body. So all this, and that is why a human body is supposed to be the supreme and complete. Okay.
God having now gained full consciousness in human form, the need no longer persists for additional or higher forms to evolve consciousness, as this consciousness gained is full and complete.
Who has gained this consciousness?
God.
God having now gained full consciousness in human form, the need no longer persists for additional or higher form, there is no higher form than human being, to evolve consciousness, as this consciousness gained is full and complete. There are so many workshops, there are so many symposiums or whatever you call it, you know, where people talk about gaining additional consciousness or expanding consciousness, stretching consciousness, making consciousness more, you know. It is an impossibility because consciousness now is whole and complete. I remember once C.B. Purdom, Charles Purdom, Baba's disciple, had once asked a question to Baba, that Baba, how can you say that consciousness is complete in the first human form? Because as the years go by, I seem to be realizing so many more things which I had never realized earlier as I age. So that means my consciousness is expanding, it is growing. And Baba corrected him, it is not the consciousness, it is the awareness that is expanding or growing. The consciousness is already full and complete in the human form. Yeah, in the human form. So that was the differentiation which Baba made between consciousness and awareness.
I think so. One of the man God said, if a man gets in his first birth, if he gets the God, I think so. You only mentioned sometime back in Bombay, he can gain in the very first birth, he can become God.
But he doesn't.
See, the point is, it is the possibility is open in the very first human form, but according to my reading, it has never happened. It can never happen because it is not pure consciousness. It is consciousness muddled with or mixed with mountains of impressions or samskaras, and therefore it is something like I had explained, you know, that when I am born as a first human being, my eyes are there, I can see everything. But there are blinkers like this, right? There's nothing wrong with the eyes. There's nothing wrong with the consciousness. If at all you call it wrong, it is these blinkers. And these blinkers are my impressions or samskaras. Now with progressive reincarnation, these, which is, I am just having a pee hole sort of vision, you know, is now gradually expanding. expanding, expanding, expanding. Eyes are the same, but I am able to be aware of so many more things which I was not aware of initially, because my samskaras are or impressions are becoming thinner and thinner, fainter and fainter, weaker and weaker, rarefied and rarefied. So gradually it is expanding. It will come up to this level on the sixth plane of consciousness, which, where it is almost, I can see almost everything, what I could see only this much initially. But still the blinkers are there. Only when this entire, impressions or sanskaras are totally dropped, totally dissolved in the final stage, when I will be kicked by a perfect master, Sadguru, or the avatar, who is the eternal living perfect master, then I will realize that I always had the eyes to see everything right from day one. But I could not see, not because there was something wrong with the eyes, but because they were covered with impressions. So in the very first human form, it is doable, but it is well nigh impossible. It's getting me.
He can.
That's what I'm saying. I'm also saying the same thing. He can, but he's not able to do it because of this impression. He can. Mike. Take the mic, please. For the benefit of those who are online, if at all.
When you say first human birth, person cannot attain godhood or attain moksha,
God realization.
Because of crude animal sanskaras?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
That's what I understand.
Yeah. Because of the load of conscious, of sanskaras, he can do it, but he is unable to do it. Something like
because
that.
Because though the three bodies are complete, what is sanskaras are the last dropped animal form. He's holding those sanskaras. So, unless and until he finishes that, so but then he's adding new. So that is why the chakravyuh goes on.
So consciousness is evolved.
Yes.
However, the sanskaras of crude animal sanskaras.
The sanskaras are sticking to the consciousness, like a leech, not allowing us to realize the I am God state.
Yeah. Though the propensity.
Why are you talking about the first human form? Now so many millions of form, human forms, still we are struggling with
maybe
the same
this could
thing.
Be our last 84, because having known of Baba's name and his literature, hope we can make this the last life, a last. This should help us to think that way.
Mike.
Somewhere. Mani and Erich were going to this Haridwar or some very spiritual place, and Mani told Baba that, see, this man is standing on his one feet in 6 months and 8 months, and this fellow is doing this and meditation. So Baba told...
We did that earlier. Huh? Yeah.
Sorry, I was...
No, it's okay. Nahin. Baba said... So, what? Okay, you complete Nahin. Your thought process.
No, my thought process is that the Baba lovers, those who are Baba lovers, we have also gone through all this, and that's why we are so close to.
Maybe.
Because you see, there are crores and crores of people are there, but how many of them are following Baba? Few lakhs.
Correct.
So,
yeah.
Okay, this is my thinking.
Yes.
We must have progress.
There is there is nothing wrong with positive thinking. We have gone through all this and now we are fortunate to be in Baba's orbit of his love. Yeah, I agree. Although I may not know whether I have done such a thing, but there's no harm in thinking that I must have done. That's why I have earned a place in Baba's love orbit, ambit. Yeah, correct.
During the process of evolution of consciousness, the consciousness, while identifying God consciously with varied finite gross forms, inanimate and animate, was also simultaneously, though unconsciously, identifying God with his limited subtle form, and his limited mental form.
We have done that. The simultaneously with the development of gross forms, unconsciously, unknowingly, we are also developing. Here Baba is saying God is identifying unconsciously with his subtle form and mental. Same thing.
These forms associated with the limited gross form of God in compact and homogeneous unconscious association throughout the process of evolution of consciousness from the very advent of the first original projection of the latent nothing in everything.
These forms associated with the limited gross form of God in compact and homogeneous. Homogeneous would mean alike, same, similar type. Homogeneous unconscious association throughout the process of evolution of consciousness from the very advent of the first original projection of the latent nothing in everything. In other words, from the very first, very finite, when it came out from the so-called Om point, it had simultaneously started associating very closely, not just with the gross form or medium, but also simultaneously, unconsciously though, developing the subtle form and the mental form.
It is but natural that together with the evolution of greater and greater consciousness of God, the evolution of the limited and finite subtle and mental forms simultaneously takes place till in human gross form, the limited subtle and mental forms of God are fully developed.
That means in the first human form, even the subtle and the mental forms are fully developed. No, needs no explanation.
Though God has gained full consciousness in human form, and though the limited subtle and mental forms are also fully developed in human form, yet the full consciousness so gained is only of the gross, which gives experience only of the gross world.
So here now is important to understand, although simultaneously with the gross form being complete, the subtle and the mental forms are also complete, but the samskaras being predominantly gross, the experience of that soul is only connected with the gross world. Although he has developed the subtle body and the mental body. Here, I'll just repeat. Though God has gained full consciousness in human form, and though the limited subtle and mental forms are also fully developed in the human form, yet the full consciousness so gained is only of the gross, which gives experience only of the gross world. Today, we are all only gross conscious. We have a subtle body. We use the subtle sphere in a sense to some extent when we are dreaming. But we are doing that unconsciously, indirectly. We are thinking, we are feeling, we are having thoughts, we are having rationale, we are logical. We are using that aspect of the mind, which is thoughts and feelings, but unconsciously, indirectly. We are not in the mental world, but we are in the gross world. And therefore, our control or responsibility or accountability is only concerning gross actions.
Hence, the fully gained consciousness is not yet conscious of the subtle and mental forms, nor does it consciously experience the subtle and mental worlds.
We cannot experience consciously the subtle and mental world.
In short, though God in the human state has gained full and complete consciousness, he is still not conscious of his limited energy of the subtle form, nor of his limited mind of the mental form. Much less is he aware of or conscious of himself as the one indivisible, eternal and infinite God with unbounded power and unlimited knowledge.
So in other words, since he is not even conscious of his subtle form and mental form, leave aside him being conscious of himself as God. That means unlimited, infinite, unbounded, whatever, right?
At this stage, God is only fully conscious of his identity with human form and its varied gross aspects and experiences in full only the gross world as an ordinary human being of the world in the form of man or woman.
So his experience is only circumscribed or limited to the gross world because his samskaras are predominantly gross. The moment this grossness gets eroded and it transforms into subtle, then he will enter the spiritual plane, the first plane of consciousness. He will have no consciousness of gross and he will identify himself as a subtle conscious human being and he will be living in the subtle world. Although he will have a gross body, he will be eating, drinking, sleeping, we've done that in the past, but his consciousness will be focused in the subtle that way.
But the consciousness of man together with his mental form or as the mind, his subtle form as energy.
As energy.
Yeah, as energy and his gross form as the body are all the outcome of the manifestation of the most finite nothing as infinite nothingness, which was latent in the God is state.
So all that we are experiencing is nothing but a sort of, you know, manifestation of that nothing which poured out as nothingness from the God is state.
In other words, the limited mind, the limited energy and the finite body are all of the nothing, and the consciousness of the limited mind, the limited energy and the finite body is also of the nothing.
That you know.
In man, the mind is the seat of desires and thoughts, energy is the seat of force and vigor, and the body, typifying happiness, is the seat of happiness and misery. These desires and thoughts, force and vigor, happiness and misery are respectively the finite aspects of the limited mind, energy and body of man.
Now Baba is, see, that the trio nature, all knowledge, all power, all bliss, whereas here it is finite, that is infinite, there is finiteness. So we have ignorance and knowledge. In terms of bliss, we have got happiness and sorrow. In terms of power, we are having power, and many times we experience helplessness. So these are the finite aspects of the infinite trio nature, which we are experiencing as ordinary, normal human beings.
Although these aspects of the finite basis of the triple nature of man, the mind, the energy and the body.
When Baba writes, talks the body, he always writes typifying happiness. That means it is equivalent to the body, the samvedna, as we say, you know, the sensation is concerned with giving us happiness and sorrow.
A body typifying happiness are finite due to the fact that they are the outcome of manifestation of the most finite nothing, yet these finite aspects of mind, energy and body demonstrate their capabilities ad infinitum.
Ad infinitum, Baba had already said, you know, because that nothingness was co-joined sort of, you know, and supported by the infinity of God, and therefore, although it may appear to be limited, it goes on expanding ad infinitum.
This is because each of these finite bases of the triple nature of man, the energy, the mind and the body typifying happiness, is closely linked with and upheld by each of the three infinite bases of the trio nature of God, Sat, Chit, Anand, infinite power, infinite knowledge and infinite bliss.
There it is infinite, here it is finite.
In fact, the fact is that when the latent infinite trio nature of God is gradually manifested out of the gradual projection of the finite nothing, and when it simultaneously protrudes the projection of the finite nothing as nothingness manifested ad infinitum, this very same infinite trio nature of God at this stage of manifestation becomes enmeshed in the apparent and false infinity of the nothingness, and thus gets itself expressed as the finite triple nature of man with capabilities demonstrated ad infinitum.
Let me read this paragraph again. The fact is that when the latent, infinite, trio nature of God is gradually manifested out of the gradual projection of the finite nothing, and when it simultaneously protrudes, which means it will go beyond or bulge outward, it is projecting from there, it protrudes. The projection of the finite nothing as nothingness manifested ad infinitum, the very same infinite trio nature of God, at this stage of manifestation, becomes enmeshed. Enmeshed would mean entangled, interwoven. You know, it has become one. It enmeshes in the apparent and false infinity of the nothingness, and thus gets itself expressed as the finite triple nature of man with capabilities demonstrated ad infinitum. The simple understanding would be that the trio nature, infinite trio nature of Satchitanand is there in the Godhead state, and when the creation took place and when it produced, because it is so closely connected, you know, it also protrudes and intermingles with the man's finite capability of mind, energy, and happiness. Am I making sense? Basically, it means, but what happens is, it is getting enmeshed, which in other words, the so-called infinity of God is poured into the finiteness of a human experience. So, but because of the existence of samskaras, we are not able to access that infinity, because the samskaras is making a cover, sort of enveloping it, not allowing us to access that particular power or knowledge or bliss. This is how I would understand.
How, one, the mind, two, the energy, and three, the body, as the triple nature of man, demonstrate their capabilities ad infinitum in illusion is clearly experienced, one, through the inventive mind of a scientist who finds no end to discoveries and inventions.
Now, how that mind of infinite mind is now protruding in a human mind, Baba says, he's giving an example, mental, energy, and then body. He says that through the inventive mind of a scientist, who finds no end to discoveries and inventions. We are seeing that in the last maybe 100, 200 years, and this is what we understand, that when the avatar comes, there's a huge leap in everything, including in illusion. So we are able to discover so many new things which were not there, or maybe they were there, but they were eroded. You know, we now know that maybe 20,000 years back, 30,000 years back, these temples were made so scientifically. So they were there, but that knowledge is all gone. So now it is being revived. So the scientists today are reviving all those lost data by discoveries and by inventions.
Clearly experienced, one, through the inventive mind of a scientist who finds no end to discoveries and inventions. Two, through the release of nuclear energy in illusion, which has reached a stage where it threatens with its own force of illusion to destroy the very nothingness out of which it emerged and evolved into such a terrific force.
Energy. Sorry. Nuclear energy has come from the nothingness. Energy can be used so gainfully, the nuclear energy, in order to, you know, have electricity, solar energy, wind power. These are all energies. But Baba says that nuclear energy can be used in the wrong way, as a result of which it can threaten its own being by being used. See, here it says, which has reached a stage where it threatens with its own force of illusion to destroy the very nothingness out of which it emerged and evolved into such a terrific force. So that means nuclear energy is such a terrific force, it can be gained, it can be gainfully used in such a positive, progressive way that we can have power, we can have electricity, we can have everything, but it can be also used in the negative way.
Number three, through the body typifying happiness, which now keeping pace with the advanced progress of evolution of the nothing, is infinitely urged to seek greater and greater happiness to such an extent that happiness actually becomes the very basis of the life of illusion.
Today, we have got so many gadgets, gadgets of comfort, gadgets of conveniences. The bottom line is why we are developing all these things. In order to have happiness. And Baba says here also in the negative sense, what happens is that we are urged to seek greater and greater happiness to such an extent that happiness actually becomes the very basis of life, of the life of illusion. Whereas the basis of life, we are pursuing happiness to a point where we are saying that happiness is the be-all and end-all of our life, that way.
The only reason for such infinite demonstration in the field of nothingness, which is illusion, is because the basic finite triple nature of man, energy, mind and happiness of nothingness, is upheld and stretched out ad infinitum by the basic infinite triune nature of God, infinite power, infinite knowledge and infinite bliss of everything.
So in other words, what Baba is trying to convey, I assume, is that although it is finite, it is joined and upheld by the infinite knowledge, power and bliss. It is connected. It has got the basis of that. And therefore, even though it is finite, it is advancing and it is developing and it is growing ad infinitum. Otherwise, it would have stopped somewhere. But because it is co-joined, because it is upheld by the infinite power, knowledge and bliss, these even these finite aspects are going on growing ad infinitum.
Infinite power is unbounded and is never reduced nor exhausted, whereas finite energy, though linked with infinite power, is reduced and exhausted because it is only the outcome of the nothing manifested as the finite energy of nothingness.
So now Baba is comparing these two. Infinite power is infinite. It is never short, there's no shortage of that. It can never be exhausted. But Baba says the finite power which we are using can be exhausted. It has an end for the simple reason that it is the result of the nothingness. Although it is linked, it has got its own limitations. Similarly, infinite knowledge.
Infinite knowledge is eternal, uniform and all-pervading and therefore is without a break in its continuity. The limited mind, however, though linked with infinite...
Though all these things are linked with the infinity, yeah.
With infinite knowledge is annihilated and made to vanish ultimately because it is the outcome of the nothing manifested as the finite mind of nothingness.
Okay, so there will come a time when this so-called knowledge will end. In fact, if we are talking about knowledge, it is knowledge of ignorance. If we are talking about any knowledge at our level, we are talking only through the experience of the mind, you see. And ultimately, the fag end of the journey, the mind has to go. And that is not the knowledge that Baba is talking about, because all this knowledge that we talk about, Baba says, this is knowledge of ignorance. But it is important that we know and get the knowledge of ignorance subsequently to be dumped as manonash, final annihilation of the mind.
Infinite bliss is bliss eternal and continual, and because it is perpetual, it is without any opposite aspect. Happiness, on the other hand, although linked with infinite bliss, is not perpetual, and therefore it has an opposite aspect of misery.
The bliss we are talking about, infinite happiness, is unending. It has no opposite. But here, although this happiness is linked with the happiness or bliss of God, this has a finite aspect and therefore it has an opposite aspect of suffering or misery.
This finite happiness vanishes even though it is the very basis of the life of the human being, because life itself is transient.
As transient means impermanent, not perennial, not perpetual.
As the life of illusion is the outcome of the nothing manifested as the life of nothingness, this life must perish. A stage is reached when man, in his travail to realize God, ultimately loses his basic finite triple nature, that is body typifying happiness, energy and mind, and realizes the basic infinite triune nature of bliss, power and knowledge. In this state, man experiences that his nature is not the finite body typifying happiness, but is infinite bliss. Not the finite energy, but infinite power. Not the finite mind, but infinite knowledge. Thus, man loses his basic finite triple nature and realizes that his is the basic infinite triune nature of God. This means that the basic finite triple nature of man, which was upheld by the basic infinite triune nature of God, is unlinked from the basic infinite triune nature of God.
Let me read this. A stage is reached, that means after several reincarnations, a stage is reached when our consciousness, becomes more mature in the sense less of samskaras or impressions. A stage is reached when man, in his travail would mean hard labor, arduous, painful journey to realize God, ultimately loses his basic finite triple nature. That means the basic finite triple nature, which is body, typifying happiness. Typifying would mean representing or exemplifying happiness, energy and mind, and realizes the basic infinite triune nature of bliss, power and knowledge. In other words, now he has graduated from experiencing the finite nature, finite triple nature, to experiencing the real infinite triple nature of God. In this state, man experiences that his nature is not the finite body typifying happiness, but is infinite bliss. Not the finite energy, but infinite power. Not the finite mind, but infinite knowledge. Thus, man loses his basic finite triple nature and realizes that his is the basic infinite triune nature of God. This means that the basic finite triple nature of God, this means that the basic finite triple nature of man, which was upheld by the basic infinite triune nature of God, all this time it was upheld, it was supported, it was linked to the infinite triune nature of God, is unlinked. Now the link is broken. The finite nature has died, and now he is experiencing the infinite triune nature of God. I'll read the last sentence again. This means that the basic finite triple nature of man, which was upheld by the basic infinite triune nature of God, is unlinked from the basic infinite triune nature of God. Unlinked in the sense, now it does not require the linkage, the continuity of the finite based on the infinite, because the entire finite is now gone, dumped, dissolved, over and out, and now that particular man at a particular stage in life experiences, that means realization, the triple nature of the infinite triple nature of God.
Although the man loses his basic finite triple nature, the full consciousness that he gained in his travail is not lost, because full consciousness once gained is never lost except in gross misuse of the powers of the fourth plane as previously described.
So again and again Baba is emphasizing that come what may, whatever may have happened, the consciousness which is once gained, it has been gained as an ordinary human being, in spite of the fact that the finite triple nature of the human being is lost, and the infinite trio nature of God is gained, the consciousness remains all throughout. Consciousness is never lost. So that is what Baba is trying to say here.
In this state, with consciousness intact and complete, the limited and finite body typifying happiness, the limited and finite energy, and the limited and finite mind are all totally unlinked from the unlimited and infinite bliss, power, and knowledge respectively.
That means unlinked should be taken as positively. It was linked because it was getting the power from that source. It was supported by that source when I was finite. But now I have myself become infinite. So there is no question of keeping the link. The link is snapped and now I am experiencing my infinite trio nature of infinite power, knowledge and bliss.
This is the stage when man is fully conscious and yet no longer experiences the false finite nothingness as real and infinite.
All this while we were experiencing the false finite nothingness as if it was real and infinite. That means knowing the false as false is knowing the truth. The birth of the real, instantaneously, automatically, and spontaneously brings about the death of the false. It is not something that it will come and then gradually. It's something like when you were, if you were to be asked, you know, there is a cave, gufa, which has been dark, pitch dark, for 10,000 years, let us say. How much time would it take to lighten up? 10,000 years, 5,000 years, 1,000 years, one day, 1 hour? No. Instantaneously, you light a match or you put a torch or you switch on the light. Howsoever dark it may have been for how many eons, it will take only 1 second to light it. In the same way, although we have traveled through millions of lifetimes, not just in a human form, but in so many other forms, how much time will it take to realize it is just a split second? The preparation for that moment may take millions of years. But when that moment arrives, the knowledge dawns, the light is lit in a moment. So it is automatic, it is spontaneous, it is instantaneous. The death of the false will immediately follow the birth of the real. That's what we are trying to convey.
The body typifying happiness, energy and mind, which were instrumental in giving the experience of the nothingness, no longer grip the consciousness of man with finite impressions.
Now the consciousness of the man, finite man, is not in the grip of the impressions. The grip is gone. It was throttling like this. Everything is gone. Now consciousness is free and it is able to experience the I am God state.
These are now unlinked and have simply vanished from the focus of the consciousness.
Simply vanished, like yesterday we did. What happens when you wake up? You have been dreaming, long dream. It may be a beautiful dream. It may be a nightmare. But the moment you awaken, where is the dream? It never was. It was just an imagination. In the same way, when we awaken in the real sense, all these that we are going through will just vanish in a moment. It was as if it never has been.
They must vanish because they were of the finite nothing by nature, which literally means absolutely nothing. But before body, energy and mind ultimately lose their grip over the consciousness of man. There is one predominant experience which he has in his everyday life, that of sleeping and waking each day. This fundamental experience in a normal man gives rise to three basic states in his everyday life. The first state is the sound sleep state, or the state of complete unconsciousness of the self in man.
Baba is talking about the three states of consciousness we all go through in our day-to-day living.
The second state is a dream state, or the semi-conscious or semi-awake state.
The second stage is the dream state. So that means, in my understanding, every day when we come out of the sound sleep state into the awake state, which is of course a false awake state, we have to necessarily pass through the pathway of the dream state. And that dream state may be for a few seconds or it may be for a few hours, but that is the pathway through which we go. If we remain a lot of time in the dream state, then when we wake up, we are able to recollect what we dreamt. But if the dream state is of very short duration and you come out from the sound sleep state into the awake state in a jiffy, then you know you dream something, but the moment you awake, you don't remember what the dream was. So that is how Baba says that if you remain in that dream. Similarly, when you go into the sound sleep state, you go via the dream state. If you hang around the dream state for a long time, you know, then it takes an effort to go into the sound sleep state and to invigorate yourself and to refresh yourself, you know. That is why sometimes people don't feel fresh when they get up in the morning, because they feel that they have been very little in the sound sleep state and a lot of time in the dream state.
The third stage is completely awake state, or the state of complete consciousness of the self in man as man. Now, man's cognizance is life in man, and man's life is made cognizant through the actions of man.
Cognizance would mean perception, self-awareness. The point is, what is man's cognition? Is the life in man, what life I am leading in man as a man, is make all the difference. And the man's life is made cognizant through the actions of man. And that is why in an ordinary, gross, conscious human being, what holds paramount is the actions. Because man's cognizance is actions. I am held responsible and accountable for all my actions. I am not so much responsible for what thoughts I'm getting, for what emotions I'm having, for what feelings I'm having, irrespective of the dirtiest, ugliest, filthiest, so-called sinful thoughts and feelings. As long as they are not put into action, your accountability or responsibility is to that extent reduced. No doubt thinking and all that may also create some samskaras which are very feeble because you have not put it into action. So man is equal to action. That is why Baba keeps saying, you know, that you may get, I am not of mental plane. So I do not know why the thoughts are coming, where they are coming from. All kinds of muddled up thoughts. Okay, just be a witness, watch the thoughts, do not put it into action. And that is why Baba says, let my name, Baba, 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 serve as a net, mosquito net, around you, so that in spite of the mosquitoes buzzing around you, that means the thoughts buzzing around, it will not be able to bite you. That means it will not compel you to put it into action. So that is what Baba is saying. So in short, there are many people, I'm digressing a little, many, many people who beat themselves up. They get into a sense of depression. They are so guilt conscious. They become very guilty. They feel, I am no good. I am such a sinner. I am absolutely not worthy of being called the Baba lover, blah, blah, blah. Why? Because they get dirty thoughts. Who does not get? Everyone gets it. As long as you do not convert them into action. So that is the paramount important thing. Now man's cognizance is life in man, and man's life is made cognizant to actions of men.
Actions are generated by the impressions of man and vice versa.
Very important. Actions are generated by the impressions in men. How do I get a thought? Because there is an impression. Because there is an impression, there is a thought. If the impression was not there, the oft-repeated, which I have been saying it in the Bombay Center, and I always use this example of my dear friend Sam Patel. Sam and myself, we are moving around Colaba area, hand in hand, and we see a board, Rustamji Beer Bar. I have been seeing this very often. Now, I am a drunkard. I love drinking. And Sam is a teetotaler. It's not like that, but for example's sake. Now, if he's a teetotaler, if he has never ever experienced what is a beer or what is a whiskey or rum, he doesn't have those samskaras. He doesn't have those impressions. And because he doesn't have those impressions, when he reads that board, Rustamji Beer Bar, nothing happens to him. Nothing is triggering him. Nothing is exciting him. But since I have had the experience of what is beer and how beautiful it feels and how my wife is shouting at me all the time, I have these impressions in me. So the moment I see that, something happens in me and I feel, chalo, hum log jayenge. That means impressions create the thoughts. With impressions and thoughts, I'm having a feeling. And because all these things gang up together and compel me, in a sense it impels me, to take the action of entering the bar and having a drink. So in other words, it is the impression here. Why I told all this? Actions are generated by impressions. If there are no impressions, there will not be any actions generated because there is no trigger point to tell me do this or don't do this. So impressions generate actions. Actions are generated by impressions of men and vice versa. That means the moment I go and have a drink, what is happening? I am liquidating, expending, that means spending, the impression which triggered me and said, have a drink. So that impression is gone. But I had a drink. When I had a drink, I had an experience. When I had experience, there is another impression which goes and again stands in the queue so that next time it will inspire me or conspire against me to have this drink. So in other words, actions are generated by impressions of men and vice versa. Impressions create actions. Actions create impressions. And clearly understood. Now you will not forget.
Cyrus.
1 minute.
Cyrus. In the presence of Baba also, the Mandali people used to get, and Baba used to ask,
yes.
What are you thinking? If there's some dirty thoughts are there, then Baba would say, tell me in my ears.
Yeah, correct. So in other words, why is it happening? Simple, what we are trying to convey is, because there is impression, there is a thought. Because there is thought, we feel. And because these all three gang up together and make me put into action. As long as I do not put it into action, those impressions have, it's like a torchlight, you know. It has flashed. The energy is exhausted. I'm not recharging the battery through actions. And over a period of time, this torchlight will exhaust the battery and it will have no grip or hold over me. Elsewhere, Baba is saying that your clock is already wound. That means the impressions are there. Let it unwind through time to time. It will keep on ringing, you know, like in an alarm clock. But take care not to wind it again. Winding the clock would mean putting those alarms into action again. Now, if we put it into action, in short, what we are trying to understand is, it is the action for which we are accountable and responsible, for which itself will create further gross impressions or samskaras, which will have to be experienced in the future. Basic. You had a question? No.
These impressions of man are picked up and imprinted on the mind of man by actions.
Where are these impressions imprinted? In the mental body, on the mind. These impressions of man are picked up and imprinted on the mind of man by actions.
Impressions and actions are thus interdependent, because impressions are fed by actions and actions are motivated by impressions.
Simple. Very logical, very understandable. Go ahead.
As said previously, the source of impressions is traced as far back as the latent nothing in the everything, which means God in the God is state.
Right from the God in the God is state, the impressions were there. They were in the latent form. When this urge came and creation started, these impressions also started.
When the nothing first became manifested as nothingness in the shape of creation, the primal manifestation of the nothing gave rise to the first trace of consciousness in God, and hereupon the first impression of nothingness manifested. This first impression procreated impressions with the evolution of consciousness.
There is a procreation of impression, one after the other, one after the other. And it has not stopped even now. Baba says that the opportunity of a new birth is to spend all the impressions and realize God. But in the process of spending the impressions, what you are doing is you are accumulating more impressions than what you have brought for spending. And that is why this vicious circle keeps on happening. It is not that the impressions have stopped after becoming a human being. It keeps on going on and on.
Accordingly, all impressions are of the nothing. And as nothing literally means nothing, these impressions are naturally nothing but mere impressions.
So in the light of the truth or reality, nothing has ever happened, nothing is ever going to happen. All these law of karma and creation and impression and expression and involutionary path and everything is in the domain of nothingness or illusion. But we will get to know this experience experientially only when we reach the goal, and then we realize that it was all a dream.
But because it was through these very impressions of nothing that consciousness evolved fully and completely in man, the consciousness of man is closely linked with these impressions of nothing and makes man consciously experience this false nothing as everything and real.
That is the humor, that is the, you can say humor only, that we are experiencing all these false nothing as if it is real. We are so self-hypnotized, so to speak.
As everything and real. Nothing is everything and real.
We are experiencing the false nothing as everything and real. Basically, this is just a shadow. It is just nothing. But because we are still in that so-called divine dream state, we are dreaming. Because we are in the dream, we are not experiencing the dream as a dream. Only when we wake up, we will experientially know and experience that all that was just a dream. Till such time, I would feel, let us enjoy the dream and not be sorrowful about it. Many people are depressed, compressed, whatever you call it, you know. I don't know what it means, you know. They get all kinds of negative feelings and emotions. Once we realize that this is all a dream, it is nothing into nothing, it has no real astitva. By and large, we are able to face life's situation in a very positive way. When we start the, mostly I start with this prayer, nothing is real but God, nothing matters but love for God. God is the only reality. All else that seems real is illusory. God and I are one, Meher Baba. So basically everything is an illusion. We may not experience it as illusion. I'm not experiencing, but at least the intellectual knowledge that all this is just a drama. It's just a show which is happening on the screen. Nothing is really happening. Then by and large, we are able to face life's situations more positively. Like when we go to a film, are we through with the sentence? So we stop here. When we go to a film, a cinema show, there's a screen, there is a rainfall, thunder, rainfall, torrential rain. You go and touch the screen, it is dry. You see on the screen fire, houses are on fire, Kumbhawala fire brigade is coming, and you go and touch the screen, it is not hot at all. Nothing is happening there. It is just a bhram, it's just a dikhawa, it's just a show which is being reflected on the screen of what is already shot in the reel. The reel is already shot. This is the life that I am leading. And whatever comes to my consciousness, which means whatever I am experiencing in life, the good, the bad, the ugly, is it cannot come. It can never come in my experience if I have not shot it in the film. As I always say, if you have shot Amitabh Bachchan, then Shah Rukh Khan will never come on screen, because it is Amitabh Bachchan whom we have shot. So in the same way, all my experiences in life is nothing but the result of the cause which I have sown in the past. Is nothing but the harvest, you know harvest, of the seeds which I have sown in the past. If I have not sown the seeds of Karela, I will not get Karela as the harvest. But if I have sown Karela and I am expecting Apus, I will never get it, because my seeds are such. So instead of focusing or being conscious of the harvesting season, which we are all, oh, poor man, what is happening to me? I have not done anything wrong. Why is it happening? Blah, blah, blah. We should be focused on the sowing season. What are we sowing today, now, which will harvest in the future? Whatever harvest is, you can't change the harvest. You cannot do anything with the harvest. But you can, you have a right and, authority to sow the seeds of whatever positivity, so that it may come as a harvest in the future. I think we are almost done. We are already 2 minutes past. Sorry. So any questions? Understood?
Question, but one story I remember, when Princess Norena, or I don't know, I would use, she brought some people for Baba's darshan, and then Baba played some record which was not very good, and these people did not like at that. And that Norena or whosoever, you may be knowing them.
Princess Norena Machibel.
She was. So she asked Baba, why Baba you did that? So Baba said, there is no connection.
Correct.
My point is, because we are connected, we are with him.
Right.
There are
right.
many people who want, even if he wants to connect. They can't, because it is not his wish.
Absolutely.
That's why I was telling
you. So we have this great good fortune, and we must make optimum use of
it by
loving him more and more. Loving him would mean loving everybody more and more, not to criticize, not to judge, not to evaluate, not to backbite, not to slander, but just consider the other as the image of God, God playing the role of ABCD. And when you do that on an ongoing basis, perhaps Baba's grace may fall upon us and say, Tathastu, now you don't need to go back. Come, let's enjoy.
That's why Baba said, remember me in your last moment, but start remembering from now, so right. that you will not find it difficult to remember me when your end approaches you.
Absolutely. Right. Thank you.
We have to consider ourselves lucky, I say. Whether you agree with me or not.
Avatar Mehe Baba Ki Jai. Thank you, beloved Baba, and thanks to all of you. Next Saturday, Sunday, again we are meeting at the same place, same time. After that, I'm not sure because MPR will close. We have made an appeal to the authorities to say whether they will allow us to continue. If they allow us to continue, irrespective of anybody there or not, Baba is always there and will try to read God's speaks and put it on across the YouTube. Thank you, Baba. Avatar Meher Baba Ki Jai.